Okay, so tonight in class, we're going to be studying what's called the Azharot. Okay, we're going to be studying what we know as the Azharot. We're going to take a look for a few minutes in the beginning as to what the Azharot are exactly. And then we're going to move on to study a few of the Azharot with a little bit of commentary that I feel will give a little bit of inspiration leading up to Shavuot. So to understand the Azharot, we have to first understand what Azharot are. Okay, what are the Azharot? Part of my childhood memories, when I was around Bar Mitzvah age and above. Someone's unmuted. One second. Sorry, just make sure if you're unmuted to mute yourself, because otherwise there gets feedback on the other end while I'm speaking. So as I was around Bar Mitzvah age, Azharot was a very important custom that I felt very much a part of growing up. You know, when I was around 13 years old, I would go to my uncle's house and go there right after lunch to go read the Azharot on both the first day and the second day of Shavuot. And it was a very special minhag. It was something very special for me to be able to experience. The Azharot for me were a custom that not just the singing of the Azharot, but the learning of the Azharot, the reading of the special words of the Azharot really inspired me during the holiday of Shavuot. And so for me, I think the reason of this choice of topic, out of all topics, you know, we could have studied the Ten Commandments. Actually later, Rabbi Azenkot will actually be teaching the Ten Commandments. But I could have chosen many topics. I'm sorry, I'm going to pause for a moment. So this choice for me is because it was something very special in terms of Shavuot for me. And actually encompasses a lot of what Shavuot is about. And let me explain. The Azharot, let me just open it up over here. Mr. Joey Moseri has a wonderful article on the Azharot he wrote this article a few years back in the SCA's Kol HaKahal, and he spoke about what the Azharot were. And we have to keep in mind, the Azharot are a poetic enumeration of all the 613 mitzvot. The Azharot are poetically listing for us the mitzvot in the form that the poet decided to put them in. And there were many poets, and by these poets, I don't mean modern poets of these days or poets that you know of necessarily in school. These are more poets in terms of hachamim, right? Like Rabbeinu Saadia Gaon, like as you see here, Rabbi Yishak ibn Jikatila, as you see here, number four. And famously, the Azharot that we know of Rabbi Shlomo ibn Gabirol. Rabbi Shlomo ibn Gabirol was one of the poets living in the year 1022 to around 1053 or 1058. And he wrote a listing of the 613 mitzvot in poetic form that we have the minhag of reading outside of Israel. We read it on the first and second day of Shavuot. In Israel, you would read it on just the one day of Shavuot. And these Azharot, again, lists the mitzvot of the Torah in poetic form. And there's a beauty to this poetry. Let me explain. You know, poetry many times is not fully appreciated. And part of understanding the mitzvot we will study in a few minutes is understanding the beauty of the poetry of our hachamim, right? Just to give you an excerpt from an article from a class that I gave a few years ago, that the intention of a piyut, when piyutim were written, right? When the hacham wrote down a pizmon or a piyut, what was the purpose of it? The purpose was to increase a person's connection to HaKadosh Baruch Hu through song. And as you see here in the underlines, the Golden Age of Spain was the most influential period of piyutim in Jewish history. Okay? And as we see here in number two, the prolific poets during this time included Shlomo ibn Gabirol, Moshe ibn Ezra, Yehuda HaLevi, and Rabbeinu Avraham ibn Ezra. All names that you're probably familiar with. And their lives were about piyutim, were about song. And so the songs that we chant on Shavuot, called the Azharot, let's look for a moment at the book we're probably used to. Many of you might have this at home. You might have this in your Mahzorim as well. The Shalom Yerushalayim put out a version of the Azharot with an English translation and annotations, right? I have this book over here, and it has in it the Azharot. As well, what we'll be studying tonight a little bit more is a version of the Azharot written and explained by Rabbi David Biton, who was the principal of Magen David I'm assuming the 1950s or so, and we'll be studying that as well. So before I keep speaking about the beauty of the Azharot, I want to open up the Azharot for a moment. It's very important when we're speaking about something of this topic that we understand what the Azharot are. What does it mean, the Azharot? What am I talking about? Some of you have seen them before, some of you have not. So let me just open up this file for a moment of the Azharot. And let me just show you what we're talking about. What do I mean, the Azharot? Actually, by a show of hands, how many of you have recited the Azharot on Shavuot or are well aware of what the Azharot are? Just helps to know who has seen the Azharot and who has not. Okay, good. So I see a number of you have, but I know there's always some that haven't, and that's okay. That's part of the learning that we're doing. So here are the Azharot. I'm actually going to sing them. I feel that singing the Azharot will give the class participants an understanding of what the Azharot are and reminds you of the beauty of the Azharot, just so we get the idea of what we're talking about. Okay, this is the first lines of the Azharot of Rabbi Shlomo ibn Gabirol. Shemor libi mane yebim modne'ene yera'enum nedevara vaisharim vehu yislah hashma vehu yarbe osma vehu yiten chokma lehabin nimharim. So the reason why I just chanted that again is to us to feel the beauty of the Azharot. So let's give a little bit of understanding of what these Azharot are. Again, poetic. Let's look at this poetry. Shemor libi ma'ane heye bimod ne'ene hirahal el umne tevarav haisharim. As you see here, the rhyme of each end within the stanza of each section. Shemor libi ma'ane heye bimod ne'ene hirahal umne tevarav haisharim. And as you'll notice, as we go through some of the Azharot, the last word of each stanza always ends with im. And that's the way throughout the entire Azharot. Always ends with im, as you see with the colon at the end. The other parts of each stanza always end with the same rhyme. So ashma, otzma, chokma, tushiyot, lapiyot, talpiyot, ase, machse, yechase. Okay? We see the rhyme. Now let's delve in to the actual Azharot themselves. So I'm going to start, for the purpose of this class, with the Shalom Yerushalayim version, just to give us a little bit more of an overview of certain lines of the Azharot. And then we will go into Rabbi David Biton's version to study a few of them. The purpose, again, of studying it tonight is to get some inspiration for Shavuot of the meaning of some of the Azharot. So let's see right now, okay? Here are the Azharot. I'm going to ask someone to read in a moment. These are not the Azharot yet, this part. Before the Azharot, there's something called the Reshut. The Reshut means the introduction, like the permission to read Azharot is an introduction. It was written in the 11th to 12th centuries by David ben Elazar Bakuda, and his name is throughout this poetic introduction. Okay, does anyone want to read? Would anyone like to offer to read from this so that we can study it a little bit? Anybody interested? Seems like we have a few people on. No one, no takers, it looks like. Okay, I guess I'll read. Let's see, I got a chat coming in. We could read for now. It's okay. We could read versus sing if someone's interested. I like the singing. The tune for this actually is different than the Azharot themselves. The tune for this is actually goes as follows. Amon yom ze, nahalu am ze, al yad hoze, isha Elohim. So in it, Rabbi David Bakuda, explains Amon Yom Ze. Okay? Amon Yom Ze Nahalu Am Ze Al Yad Ish Hoze Ish Elohim. This is talking about the Torah. Okay, this commentary in Hebrew was written by Rabbi Aluf, and he explains that Amon is the Torah. The Torah was given to us, and we inherited it. We inherited it by the hands through Ish HaElohim. Ish HaElohim, talking about Moshe Rabbeinu. Note aliyah v'yosed neshiya lecha dumiya tehila Elohim. We are offering praise to God. We are offering praise to God through this. Yom nigleta v'dat horeta me'od na'aleta al kol Elohim. This is the day that God revealed himself on Har Sinai. And this is the day that he came, and I'm skipping through a little bit. Dat hodi'am v'kol hishmi'am. God came to teach us the Torah, to teach us the ways of living. Right? Be'ozne hamonai diber besinai.
Hey, Rabbi.
Hello. Hello. Hello, ani Adonai ve'en od Elohim. Okay? In the Be'ozne hamonai, in the ears of many, God spoke on Har Sinai, and he said, Hello, ani Adonai ve'en od Elohim. He said, I am God, and there's no other God beside me. And as you could tell, if you want to chat in, you could. If you want to unmute yourself, I don't mind. What does Rabbi David over here do as an introduction to Azharot? What part of the Torah is he pointing out over here? What part of that our Torah is Ibn Bakuda, David ben Lazar Ibn Bakuda, what is he pointing out over here? Very good. I see Moshe Mizrahi, very good. The Ten Commandments, right? In this, Ibn Bakuda is pointing out the Ten Commandments. He goes through, in a poetic listing, the Ten Commandments. So that in the introduction over here, right? Let's go through them. Halo ani Adonai, that's Anochi Hashem Elokecha. Ve'en od Elohim, there's no other God. Netosh zar ufislo, right? Netosh zar ufislo, veset omar lo, hayaseh lo, Adam Elohim. This is talking about the lo yeh lecha Elohim acherim. And in it, he explains, and he says, get rid of your avodah zara, because would a person make themselves God, or would they make other gods? Does it make sense that a person should fashion for themselves a physical God? No, says the poet. This does not make sense to do that. It doesn't make sense. Rather, God created us. We don't create God. God created us. Et shem ha'el lashav al to'el ki al ko'el gadol Elohim. God is greater than all, so don't take his name in vain. Anyone want to read the next one about Shabbat? Anybody interested in reading about Shabbat over here?
I'll read it, Rabbi.
Chavod.
Wait, yeah, I can read it?
Yeah, 21, the Chabed Shabbat.
Where is it? I can't find it.
Right here, Lechabed Shabbat.
Okay, fine. Lechabed Shabbat, Rutzna v'chibat. Ki bo Shabbat ve'achol Elohim.
Okay.
Till there,
it's perfect. That's perfect. Lechabed Shabbat, Rutzna v'chibat. Go run to honor Shabbat because God rested. And he continues on and on. Aneg omanim, give respect to your parents by giving them food. V'tarich shanim lifnei Elohim. And he goes on, and like I said, he explains all the Ten Commandments. We're not going to go through all of them, but he ends by saying, "Hai go'alenu zekof yadenu behish harenu beyesha Elohim." Right? Long live our Redeemer, God. Zekof yadenu. Zekof yadenu, meaning raise our hands up. Behish harenu beyesha Elohim. And speedily show us the deliverance of God with Yemot HaMashiach. And then the Azharot start. Now, fascinating. We just went through in a few minutes the introduction to the Azharot. We didn't even touch the Azharot themselves. So for the next part of the lesson, for the next part of this class, I actually want to look at the Azharot themselves. I won't have a chance to read every part, and that's okay. Someone asked me how long the Azharot are. So they're actually split up into 2 days. We read 182 lines on the first day, which is the mitzvot aseh, the positive commandments of the Torah, which for them, does anyone know how many positive commandments there are in the Torah? Out of the 613, how many of them are positive commandments?
Ramah.
Right, good. Ramah. Very good, Joe. Very good, Vivian. 248. There are 248 mitzvot aseh, which leaves for us the 365 lo ta'aseh. For the lo ta'aseh of the Azharot, there are many more. So there are 328 lines of the Azharot for the lo ta'aseh. They're pretty long. They're not short. But again, like I said, it's a beautiful minhag that you should get yourself used to on Shavuot. Because in Bet Knesset, or this year if you're praying at home, the minhag is in Bet Knesset. In the Tefillah, we only read a small portion of the Azharot. But when you come home after lunch, the minhag is a beautiful minhag, and Joey Mosseri mentioned this in his SEA minhag of the week. This is part of a community family minhag. You should make this part of your family. Sit down together and read these Azharot together as a family. It's a beautiful minhag. You're studying the mitzvot. You're studying them together. And the 248 mitzvot aseh, right? And then you have 365 mitzvot lo ta'aseh, which the hachamim always match with the days of the year. So here, Ibn Gabirol was the one who wrote these azharot that we have the minhag to read. His name was Rabbi Shlomo Ibn Gabirol, Rabbi Shlomo ben Yehuda Ibn Gabirol. And Ibn Gabirol wrote one version of the azharot. We should know there were many other versions, as we mentioned. And there are certain communities that have different minhagim when it comes to the Azharot. Which ones do we read? People that follow Harambam don't read these Azharot. And we'll see why in a moment. Because there are certain mitzvot that Ibn Gabirol counts in his counting, in his list, in these Azharot that he beautifully put together for us, that were mitzvot derabanan according to the Rambam. So actually, Hacham Yosef Kafich, who was a strong follower of Harambam, wrote his own set of the Azharot, following the Rambam's version of the Azharot. But now our custom is to read these. And so I'd like to look at a few of the mitzvot that Ibn Gabirol lists and read through them with the commentary of Rabbi Biton. Again, Rabbi Biton, who was the principal of Magen David in our community in the mid-1900s. He was born in Morocco in the early 1900s. And he was well known as a beloved rabbi within our community. And in it, he has a commentary on the mitzvot aseh, specifically on the mitzvot aseh. And in his commentary, he does as follows. And I want you to be familiar with this because generally, this is only once a year, this minhag, one time a year. And it's so beautiful to learn about this. He has a commentary that goes as follows. He gives you the two lines, which is that section of the mitzvot. He then gives you me'at devash, a little bit of honey. A little bit of honey of explaining the mitzvot. He gives you a ta'amu ur'u, which is sources of where these mitzvot are from. And then he gives ta'am bada'at. In ta'am bada'at, he gives you a true flavor and knowledge of the mitzvah. And I know a few of you need to leave in a few minutes because you have a program for school for some of you. So I'd like to at least get you through at least one of the mitzvot that he explains. And that one is going to be about saying 100 berachot every day. Okay? There is, in the Azharot, Ibn Gabirol lists as one of the mitzvot saying 100 berachot every day. Okay, let's find that. Over here. Here it is. Bishinan tan tamid lebincha tamid umim berachot asmid me'ata nigmarim. He says, teach your children always and your students. And then in line 36, he says, umi berachot tasmid me'at hanigmarim. What does that mean? Let's look at Rabbi Labaton Alav HaShalom's English explanation. Join 100 blessings together to complete each day. Now, where does this come from? Again, Ibn Gabirol is clearly listing this in his listing of the mitzvot. Where does this idea of 100 berachot come from? So Moshe Mizrahi, beautiful, says this comes from the Chachamim. Seemingly, this comes from the rabbis. So why in the world is he counting it within the mitzvot of the Taryag mitzvot? So I'd like to look at Rabbi Biton's commentary to explain how. Okay? So first we have to see where this comes from. There's a Gemara that says as follows. There's a pasuk in the Torah. It says, Ma Adonai Elohecha Shoel Me'imach. Right? Moshe tells Bnei Yisrael, what does God want from you? Ve'ata Yisrael Ma. Again, listen carefully to this. Ma Adonai Elohecha. That's what the pasuk says. The word Ma. What does God want from you? Ma Hashem Shoel Me'imach. And to that, the Gemara Menachot says, don't read it Ma, read it Me'ah. Okay? Me'ah Hashem Shoel Me'imach. God is asking of you 100 berachot every day. Now you tell me. You can unmute yourself if you like. You tell me. Does this sound de'oraita? Or de Rabbanan. This sound rabbinic, or that the Torah actually meant that? Guess no one wants to admit themselves.
I don't think the Torah meant it, but I think it's Chachamim.
Right. It sounds like it's from the Chachamim. And then, interestingly enough, Ibn Gabirol lists it in his listing of the mitzvot. So the question is why? So I like to read through Rabbi Biton's explanation of this mitzvah. And he says as follows. Let's open up. I actually have it to share it as an image. And let's read his explanation, because I think it's such a beautiful explanation of this idea of me'ah berachot. Hold on. Here we go. He says the following. Umi berachot tasmid me'at hanigmarim. It's not talking about the fact that when you say a beracha, God needs our berachot. Rather, kol inyan haberachot. Again, this is Rabbi Biton's commentary on it. The whole idea of berachot, hurak leorer et atzmenu bebirachenu elav, ki hu ha-mevorach makor kol haberachot, kolel kol ha-tovot. That God himself doesn't need our berachot. Rather, when we say berachot, we arouse in ourselves that God includes all good in him. And by doing that, nihiye re'uyim ma'aseh hatov hazeh le'amshich alenu birchotav, that God will bring to us beracha when we say berachot. But he says, look at the underline. Joe Sutton, you want to read? Behine ha-Torah lo siveta.
Behine ha-Torah lo siveta oto otanu b'mfurash tabarech al shum dabar lifne she'anu nohagim mimen.
Okay? The Torah doesn't tell us to do this. The Torah never instructs us to say a beracha before we eat something. What's the only mitzvah in the Torah that's a beracha? What's the only beracha in the Torah? Very good, Birkat HaMazon. Birkat HaMazon is the only beracha from the Torah. So then what's this idea that saying a beracha before can be kind of a mitzvah from the Torah? It seems strange that Ibn Gabirol lists this in the listing. So let's take a look. And he says, because when you are about to eat something, when you're about to eat a piece of food, if you didn't say a beracha, it's like stealing something from the owner of the home without any permission. And so if we say a beracha when we're full, the Gemara says, Kal vachomer, even more so, we should say a beracha when we're hungry. And therefore, a person can't take permission to eat something without asking permission. He can't just take it without asking for it. And therefore, he says that that's why the Torah instructed us only about Birkat HaMazon. But we could learn from that for before we eat as well. Because why would a person tend more to say beracha after they ate than before they ate? Moshe Mizrahi. Why would a person say beracha?
Because you finished, well, you could go both ways actually, but you finished eating, right? So now, once you finished eating, you just had a great meal, right? So now you are pretty full and you're thankful for the great meal you just had.
Okay, so it could go both ways though. Either you could be thankful for the meal you just had,
or you could see, right, a nice big hamburger and be like, oh, I really want that hamburger, so I'm going to be thankful.
Uh-huh. So, right, but it could go the other way as well, that when a person gets full, they might forget God more. Because when you're full, forget it, I'm done, I ate already. But when you're hungry, of course you're going to ask for something. So it could be that Ibn Gabirol is thinking that the Torah tells you to say a beracha after you eat, because surely you're going to say it before you eat. And so maybe Ibn Gabirol lists this as one of the 100, right, the 100 berachot, as one of the 613 mitzvot, is that clearly the Torah, by telling me I need to say beracha after I eat, that I need to say beracha before I eat. But I want to go to the next part of what he says. He asks then, so why does a person say a beracha? Why does the Torah tell me to say a beracha after you eat? When it comes from the Torah reading, we say a beracha before we read the Torah. Listen to the question. Birkat HaMazon was established after we eat. Kiryat HaTorah, we say Beracha before we learn Torah. So why? Why didn't the Torah require that we say Birkat HaMazon before we eat? You have to say this whole long prayer before we eat, and then we're allowed to eat. Only after you say a Beracha in the beginning of the day, maybe every day.
I think it has something to do with, like, after you tasted the food. Now here comes the real thank you. Before, you're saying a Beracha, and then you eat the food. But once you see how, it's like, for example, your mom's cooking, and then you say, oh, wow, mom, this is great food. But it's when you actually try the food that you really appreciate how good that
good.
Is.
Good.
I think.
What's the difference between that and Kiryat HaTorah?
Kiryat HaTorah.
Why do we say Beracha after we benefit from the Torah, after we learn Torah? Why would you say Beracha before you learn Torah? Let's say Beracha when you're done learning Torah, when you finish learning Torah, when you've got the Hana'ah from it.
Yeah, Torah is endless. It doesn't stop. There's no...
Okay, that's one answer. Very good. But there's another answer. Look over here. It says, why do we say Beracha after we eat but before we learn? He says, because it comes to physical, like you said, Marvin, you benefit from the physical and you can only enjoy the physical once you ate it. When you're learning Torah, your mind appreciates what you're about to learn even before you learned it. Right? Think, for example, you heard about this class, right? Well, actually, food would work that way also. You know, you heard about the Mazam or your Ranta class, which I can't give to you through Zoom, but maybe Zuma more, I don't know. But you can't run towards, right? When it comes to Torah, your mind functions differently than your body. Your body appreciates food only after it's done. The mind appreciates Torah even before you got to the Torah learning. It appreciates the value. So look at the underline over there. Kevan she'im ha'adam yavin besichlo she'im keshehu sava mevarech ki yishu ra'av lo oko sheken az mimela ro'e et ha'erech shel hana'av beracha gam lifnei she'achom mevarech hana'a. Now a person who understands the importance of food being our connection with God and that we eat in order to serve God, that kind of person doesn't eat like a behemah. That kind of person doesn't run to eat the food. That person appreciates the food for what it's for and says a beracha before. And very good. And we spiritually connect ourselves to the food we're about to eat. Usually the reason why we forget to say beracha before we eat is because we are jumping at it. We're so hungry, we're jumping at it. We don't stop to think and use our minds. We're using sometimes our animalistic tendencies, what he calls a halek behemi, the animalistic part of a human. I got to eat the food. But when it comes to Torah, very good. Being satisfied in a spiritual state is better than being satisfied in a physical state. Exactly. And that's what Rabbi Biton is saying over here. So this person is appreciating and understanding the beauty that the food is for the connection with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And I think for that reason, Ibn Gabirol counted this as a mitzvah from the Torah. Maybe the Torah itself, right, with that word me'ah and ma, going back to this explanation, this me'ah, right, maybe this mitzvah already existed. But now the rabbis gave us some way to hint at it. But that this mitzvah was always a mitzvah. And so maybe according to Ibn Gabirol, this can count as part of the 613 mitzvah. Yes, Moshe.
I feel like since we're celebrating Shavuot when we got the Torah, shouldn't we be reciting the mitzvot that were specifically in the Torah, if that's what we're celebrating?
But again, there is a mahloket. There's a mahloket in the Chachamim as to what constitutes a mitzvah from the 630 mitzvot, you're probably thinking much like Harambam when you're talking right now. That Harambam would say...
Wouldn't that make it 614?
No, because again, what constitutes the 630 mitzvot is a machloket. Maybe something that Harambam doesn't consider a mitzvah from the Torah. The other rabbis, for example, Ibn Gabirol lists candle lighting for Shabbat and saying the Hallel. And actually, he gives hints. There are hints towards these mitzvot that possibly can make it a deoraita. Right? For example, one can argue that the fact that a beracha is mentioned in the Torah applies to all the berachot. Right? In the Rambam way of learning it, only Birkat HaMazon is from the Torah. In the Rambam way of learning it, Halakat Nerot Shabbat is not a mitzvah from the Torah, or it can't be counted as a 613 mitzvah. But not every rabbi agreed with that. Some rabbis said some mitzvah that Rabbanan could count because the Torah told us to follow the rabbis.
Rabbi, some people you're talking about, for some people say that praying Shacharit Minchah Abid every day is like giving a neshama breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Yes, that is true. That is correct. So again, Moshe, it goes back to that question of what constitutes a mitzvah and what doesn't. So I'd like to look at one more mitzvah. I think we have time for one more mitzvah. And again, think about it. I mean, the amount of pages in this book alone that I have in front of me, Rabbi Biton, explaining the mitzvot of only the first day is a 530 plus pages of explaining every single mitzvah. And so the next mitzvah I like to look at is the mitzvah of humility and fearing the mikdash and giving respect and honor to parents and horim. I hope I have this in front of you over here. Give me a moment. If I don't, I will do a different one. I do have it. Here we go. So he talks about the idea of tuma and anava, purity and humility. Okay, purity and humility. And he says the following, Rabbi Biton. When it comes to purity, and it looks like I didn't take a picture of that page, so I'll have to read it to you. He says that purity, tuma, that's talking about being pure with God. Being pure with God means not going after superstitions, not going after the superstitious ways of connecting with God. Rather, you connect with God by doing the mitzvot. You connect with God with being tamim. And I'll tell you that one of the things I grew up with on Shavuot that I remember vividly was going to West Yil Shul to stay up on the night of Shavuot. And Rabbi Labaton, Zecher Tzadik Libracha, used to, and some of you on this Zoom were not able to meet him. Rabbi Labaton went through that night the reading of the Tikkun, the reading of the minhag we have that night to go through the Torah, the reading of the Torah. And he would stop and explain so much of the Torah. And one of the psukim that Rabbi Labaton held very dearly to was this pasuk, Tamim tihyeh im Adonai Elohecha. We have to be pure with our relationship with God. And part of that purity, and I could tell you Rabbi Labaton was someone who exemplified this characteristic, was anava, was humility. What does it mean to be humble? What does it mean to be a humble person? Rabbi Biton says something fascinating that I want each and every one of you to come out with, is that he says, humility is not just about being weak and someone doesn't speak up. He says a person who's weak, a person who's unlearned, not learned person, it's very easy for that person to be humble. But a person who's a gibor, an ashir, a hacham, a ba'al koma, a person who's strong, who's rich, who's wise, it's more difficult for that kind of person to be humble because it's easy for them to get an ego. So that person's really an anav. Ki chol ma'alotav yesh bahen kedei le'ored bo midat ha'gaava. That person has all the characteristics that will ignite ego in them. Bilachin, im adam kaze hu anav, if a person like that is humble, azai hu be'emet ra'ui l'shebeach anava. That person really deserves to be humble. Bilachin ha'torah shibeha et Moshe Rabbeinu. Why was Moshe anav me'od mikol adam? He was maybe able to be someone with an ego because he was someone who transmitted the Torah to us. So he could say, I'm the best, I'm the greatest, and he didn't. The greatness of Moshe Rabbeinu and of our Avot was their humility came despite their greatness. Despite their greatness, they were still very humble. And then he says, Rabbi Ton, he reminds us, the Midrash, why was Har Sinai picked as the mountain for Matan Torah? Why Har Sinai? And he says the following, and you know this probably, but he points it out so that we can understand this going into the holiday of Shavuot. Har Sinai nivhar mikol harim she'ashem yarad alav. Har Sinai was chosen from all the mountains. Benatan alav et haTorah liYisrael, lo biglal, not because shuaya achi gavoa, not because it was the tallest mountain, rather eladavka lahefech, rather the exact opposite. Bishvil shuaya hanamuch mikulam, ubaze ratzah Hashem lamed la'am kimo kenemidat hanava, and therefore through this, the HaKadosh Baruch Hu was teaching us humility. We learned humility through Matan Torah. And he adds to this, and we have only a couple of minutes left. He adds to this, Rabbi Biton, that Hashem points out to us, I don't love you because you're the greatest nation in terms of size. Lo minu bechem mikol ha'amim. Ki atem ham'at mikol ha'amim. You are the smallest of the nations. And despite that, it doesn't matter how great you are, right? Abraham Avinu says, Anochi afar va'efer. I'm a nobody. David says, Anochi tola'at velo ish. Meaning, they understood their position in terms of God. Being a great person does not mean that you need to have an ego. Does not mean that you need to feel powerful. It means that you have to connect with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The greatness of Am Yisrael, and I'd say the beauty of the Azharot, and the beauty of reading through the Azharot, and I'll tell you something that I mentioned to Mr. Joey Moseri tonight, because we were talking about the Azharot, and he told me a lot about the Azharot. And I told him that I felt very inspired by the Azharot, just by studying a few of them. I told him that it connected me more to God's commandments. And again, connecting yourselves to God's Torah and to God's commandment, that's what makes you great. It doesn't make you small to be part of Am Yisrael and you're part of a nation. The opposite. Being a part of the nation of Am Yisrael makes you great. Making yourself lose your ego sometimes for a fight that you're having or for learning Torah purposes or for your business purposes or whatever it is, when you sometimes are not feeling the need to be on top, it also comes along with not taking advantage of others. And that as well, I would say, and to end with another message of Shavuot from Megillat Rut, that Boaz, when it comes to Megillat Rut, what was his strength, Boaz, that he had strength? What was his greatness? His greatness was in the fact that he took care of Ruth and Naomi. He took care of others. That was his greatness. And so to end with a pasuk from the Mizmor in Shavuot, it says, Avi yetonim, yetomim v'dayan almanot Elohim bim'om kodsho. God is the Avi yetomim v'dayan almanot. He's the father of the orphans and the judger of the widows. And that's God. God up in his heavenly abode, his greatness is that he comes down and he takes care of others. That's HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So again, we should learn here to attach ourselves to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to learn his mitzvot, to spend time in Shavuot delving into his Torah, and to feeling the ability of us to be humble and at the same time following God's commandments really makes us our Torah observant Jews that are following the ways of HaKadosh Baruch Hu and the ways of Moshe Rabbeinu. So I want to thank everyone who joined tonight. In 1 minute, we're going to start with the next part of tonight with Tehillim, and then followed by Mincha and Arbit. And at 8:20, another class, a class of Rabbi Azenka, of why these commandments make me the top 10. So please stay with us for the next part of tonight. And thank you so much.
Chaim, you done?
Yep,
7:40. You could steal, I was considering that you would steal a few more minutes.
Nope.
Guys, whoever wants to do so.
Thank you very much.